Hello, you malty, marauding meanderers. Yeah, Ralphie, that's me, here at ralphie.com, reviewing whiskey for your entertainment, for your education, to enhance your opinions, to basically help you focus where you're spending your money so you get a better bang for your buck. That's important, matters to us all. But before we start with that, reviewing this interesting blended Scotch whisky, a thank you to Emil Skills for that introductory malt mention for Whisky Review 381, because that's what this is, Whisky Review 381, the concluding part of a mini-series on Scotch blended whisky, which is a combination of single malt whisky and grain whisky. Right, Black Bull, 12-year-old. You also get a 30 and a 40-year-old, but I've already reviewed the 30-year-old, and I'm come back to review the 12-year-old because it represents, in my opinion, quite good value for money in terms of the quality of the experience. It's 50% grain whiskey from a column still, 50% malt whiskey from a pot still, and it's bottled at 50% volume. So there we go. I will not be pouring 50% of the glass full of whiskey. I'll be a bit more modest than that. Just a drop. And because it's at 50% alcohol, I will be adding a reasonable amount of water, because if I don't, when I smell it and taste it, I'll just get the nip of alcohol. There we go. Small glass, half a teaspoon. On the nose, I'm immediately aware of decent quality old oak casks. You get that sense of age, even though the whisky's 12 years old. That refers to the youngest whisky involved in the bottling. And depending on the provenance of the casks used for maturing the corn spirit and the malted barley spirit, you can actually get quite old smelling and tasting whisky at a relatively young age. It's all down to the provenance and the luck of the cask. And I'm getting on the nose plenty of rich toasted oak and dried fruit, dates, a little bit of figs, sultanas most definitely. In fact, I'm getting something a little bit Glenfarclas-y. I'm also noticing that it's very hard to separate the corn or mixed grain whiskey from the column stills from the single malt. Quite tricky to, they've been very well put together, well married in the cask. It's a complex spiciness as well. Touch of toffee, slightly burnt toffee. And without doubt, on the nose, this is quite a rich, flavoursome whisky. In the taste, well, my suspicions are justified. Quite intense. There's a certain spirity note in there, and I think it's coming from the single malts more than the grain, the corn. And it tends to go right from the initial development right through to the finish as well, so it's sustained throughout the event. Not 100% sure about it. It will inevitably, invariably, knock a couple of marks off. But still, this is good, sound, interesting and engaging whiskey. The taste, rich dried fruit and fruit cake. Not particularly peaty. Quite Speyside-ish in character, sweet arrival, more tannins, drier notes in the development, vanilla certainly in the finish. tends to build up quite nicely if you just leave it alone in your mouth to kind of find its own way. And although it doesn't have a standout complexity, it still, as an all-round complexity, is really quite accomplished. There's a fruit complex and honey note in there. Some almost scones, fruit scones, home baking, fresh currants, sawdust, vanilla, and mild cherry stones. That hint of cherry stone bitterness and that touch of fresh fruit. It doesn't really stand out as much as the dry fruit, the sultana notes, tint of chocolate there, dark chocolate. Interesting, engaging, and decent. Let's give it a mark. Out of 100, and that is a blend mark. Now, something I've touched on in this series of Scotch blended whisky is the fact that there is quite a kind of split opinion as to the worthiness of standard blended Scotches, which are a combination of corn stroke wheat, mixed grain or single grain whiskies made in a column still in an overtly industrial unit, as compared to the single malts, which are 100% at all times malted barley, specifically distilled twice or three times in traditional pot stills. And they're two very different spirits. And it seems to me that there is a tendency, a bad habit, for people to make direct comparisons of blended Scotch and single malt under the one umbrella, in the one context, simply because they both come from Scotland. In my opinion, they're very different spirits. I certainly touched on it two reviews ago when I talked about William Lawson's 12-year-old, and I hinted at it when I reviewed last review 380, the Hanky Bannister, that there tends to be an attitude that if you're enjoying a blended Scotch, basically you're not trying too hard or not looking to try too hard with your sense of smell and taste. You're settling for a lesser experience. And that's really quite unfair, because they are not just different spirits, they're very different spirits. A single malt is 100% malted barley from pot stills, nothing else. Blended Scotch could involve several grains, not just corn and wheat. It's a combination of column and pot still whiskey, which by their very nature are different. They can marry well together quite successfully. They can come together in the bottle and provide quite a comprehensive taste experience. But there is that fact that exists that the two spirits, single malt and blended Scotch, they're very different and need to be assessed differently. In the same way that you would not, say, combine vodka and single malt and then say, well, it's blended Scotch. Corn whiskey's got a little bit more flavour than that. You wouldn't judge them under the same context. So it's something to have a think about, is when you come to blended Scotch whiskey, there's some really good stuff out there, and it can be much better value for money for what you're getting than some single malts. Likewise, you've always got the opportunity, if your blended Scotch is not giving you as full a flavour as you want, just add a bit more malt if you have it. It's very easy to do. There's more and more people, by the way, choosing to drink blended whiskey straight It's a kind of old-fashioned thing for a while, but it's kind of, you know, the thing about fashion is it disappears for a while, gets reinvented, and then capitalised on all over again. That's the way it is. But decent quality, quite young for a 12-year-old, actually. I think there's some refill cask in there, some larger cask as well, butts rather than barrels, that's giving it that little edge. So if you're going to buy this whiskey, and the price isn't bad for what you're getting, add a touch of water, leave it sitting out for a while, let it settle down, you'll get a fuller experience. And now let us conclude with a little message that I got from a long time malt mate called Chano. Chano lives in Denmark, and he's a big malt fan, big whiskey fan. He's been asking my opinion now and again, or pointing things out over the 4 years that I've been reviewing whiskey. And recently, Chano sent me a message, basically saying, Ralphie, I'm visiting Scotland, I'm staying in Glasgow, and I'd like to visit distilleries. And I thought to myself, well, this is an ideal opportunity to give you an opinion from Ralphie, that's me, give you an opinion on what to do, where to visit, how to organise things if you happen to be travelling to Scotland for a holiday or for a business trip or for whatever reason, visit family, etc, etc. And you want to visit distilleries. Now, the two main cities that you're going to come into are either Edinburgh on the east coast or Glasgow on the west coast, both in the south southern area of Scotland, in what's called the Central Belt. Not big cities, quite small. Both Glasgow and Edinburgh are very, very different in character. I can't think of two cities out there that are more different, that are so close to each other, actually. And you can easily get a train from Queen Street station in Glasgow to Waverley station in Edinburgh. It's not expensive, quite regular service, every 15 minutes, and it will take you between the cities within an hour. And as I mentioned, I've been on the train myself quite a number of times, so I know it's generally pretty reliable. And as you're going on the train, remember to look out the window at Linlithgow. It's a station, it's a rather an ancient town, just heading towards Edinburgh from Glasgow, and vice versa. And you will see an old distillery building if you look out the window just as you're leaving or coming into the railway station at Linlithgow. That is St. Magdalen, or Linlithgow Distillery. Now flats. Right. If you are visiting Glasgow, your two nearest distilleries are Auchentoshan at Clydebank and Glengoyne up at Strathblane. There are not regular bus services to these distilleries, so you may well find yourself having to hire a taxi or arrange for a car hire. Both distilleries, very different. If you were to visit one and then visit the other, you would really have a different experience, so it's worth doing so. Both distilleries, by the way, have had open days in the past, which have been quite decent and interesting and entertaining, so you could look out for them. If you're in Edinburgh, your option really is a little bit more restricted to Glenkinchie Distillery, which is just south of Edinburgh. It's a big distillery, and they have quite a good organised tour. They even have a model distillery as part of the tour experience. So that's really your whisky options. As regards whisky shops in Edinburgh, your main whisky shop is Royal Mile Whiskies in Royal Mile, and you've got Cadenheads down at the bottom of Royal Mile. Royal Mile is the centre of Edinburgh, and it is a must visit place if you're in Edinburgh during the Arts Festival, which is also when they have quite a notable whisky experience called the Whisky Fringe. Worth a visit. Tickets sell out quite quickly, by the way. Glasgow, two shops that I'd recommend are Good Spirits Company in Bath Street. It's a basement shop, so don't blink or you'll miss it. But you'll find the websites online. And Inverarity Vaults 121, which is further up Bath Street. And they also store and sell and stock an extensive range of wines. So those are the kind of for in terms of range of stock and at good prices, those are the shops that I would recommend, and certainly these are shops that I shop at. As regards visiting distilleries outside of Glasgow and Edinburgh, if you're wanting to visit several distilleries within a reasonable distance of each other, you're really looking at going up to Speyside, where they have quite a successful Speyside Whisky Festival, which you'll easily find the details online. So that's worth the visit. Lots of the Speyside distilleries do organise tours, but it's really something you do with a hire car. That's the best way of getting around the distilleries. So I'm afraid someone in your group is going to have to not be drinking, because you can't drink and drive. The other option is to take the ferry over to Islay. Islay has 8 distilleries, all very different, all very distinctive. And it's quite famous for its Facial Islay Whisky Festival, although things are seriously busy then. You can be absolutely strapped for getting around and finding accommodation. It is that busy. But out with the actual festival, fascinating place to visit, particularly if you're a fan of peated whisky. And you do find that the Ealachs, i.e. the people who come from Islay, are generally quite amenable and hospitable. Although, be warned, if someone is insulting you and saying it's just a local custom and, you know, not to feel insulted about it because they're just being friendly, no, they're not. They're just insulting you. Okay. It can happen. I've seen it. Highland Distilleries, the A9, which is the main trunk road that runs up north to Inverness. There are a number of distilleries up that road, including Edradour, Blair Athol, and Dalwhinnie. Very different distilleries, and all do tours as well. So that keeps you right. There are some more remote distilleries. Don't underestimate, by the way, the fact that although Scotland is a small country, it has a huge amount of jaggedy bits, which actually makes distances longer than they would appear, and it can take you about 5 hours without having to push it to get from the bottom of Scotland to the top of Scotland by road easily. And then there's the roadworks, then there's the pouring rain and all the rest of it, all these obstacles. Thank goodness at the end of it there's such a variety of interesting, engaging whisky. Final note, if you're visiting a distillery, there is a tendency, particularly with the distilleries that have the shops, to buy a bottle. Be aware that a number of distilleries have distillery-only bottlings, which are not available elsewhere. So they're what you're really wanting to look out for. But for the majority of distilleries in Scotland, they are in fact the most expensive place to buy a bottle of whisky, because essentially you're on location, and it's just custom and practice. It can be a little bit dearer than if you were to buy it in one of the main retail shops, either in Edinburgh or Glasgow. And of course, Scotland's not just about whisky. You get some fantastic real ale bars, both in Edinburgh and Glasgow, the Bon Accord in North Street in Glasgow, and the Pot Still in Hope Street, to name two. And also in Edinburgh, you're looking to get down Rose Street, which runs parallel to Princes Street. There's a lot of good bars down there. Anyway, I hope this is helpful. If you want to know more, if you happen to be visiting Scotland, check out visitscotland.com, which is the main site for picking up information. Contact the tourist information depots. They're very good at helping with accommodation and organising tours and all the rest of it. And if you visit Scotland, I hope you have a good time. I've visited a few times. In fact, I lived there for many, many years. Of course, I get too used to it. I tend to get kind of jaded, because you're in the thick of it and you actually miss out on just what fantastic buildings and what fantastic countryside there is to be found in Scotland. Hope you'll join me soon. We're going to start a new series called North, South, East, West. I'm not going to tell you any more. I'll leave it with you. See you soon.